Hey you lot, Parth here, and in this video we'll be looking at kinetic energy, a very important concept in physics, in five levels of difficulty. If you're new to the idea, then feel free to watch the whole video. If you already know a bit about kinetic energy, then feel free to skip to the bits that are new to you using the timestamps at the bottom. If you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button and subscribe for more fun physics content. Also, if you'd like to see more of these five levels of difficulty explanations, then let me know what topics to cover. For now though, let's talk about kinetic energy. Let's start with level one. What is kinetic energy? To answer this question, we can first briefly talk about what energy is, and then what specifically kinetic energy is. Energy is basically a number or a quantity that we can assign to anything we happen to be studying, which tells us something about how it is behaving or how it will behave. We can look at how energy is transferred between objects or from one type of energy to another, which allows us to mathematically predict how the thing that we're studying will act at some point in time in the future. And kinetic energy is the energy that an object has when it is moving. In fact, kinetic energy directly depends on how fast the object is moving, its speed. The faster an object moves, the more kinetic energy it has. But if it's stationary or not moving, then it has no kinetic energy. It's also worth mentioning here that kinetic energy, just like other forms of energy, is measured in joules, which is the standard SI unit for energy. Level two. So it's all well and good saying that a moving object has kinetic energy, but exactly how much kinetic energy does it have? Well, there's a convenient equation that tells us exactly this. The kinetic energy of an object that has mass m and is moving with a speed v is equal to 1/2 mv squared. So let's break this equation down. Let's say we have a wooden block with a mass of 1 kilogram, and initially it's stationary. In other words, it's moving with a speed of zero, or it's not moving. In this case, the block has no kinetic energy, just as we expect. Now let's say that it moves at a speed of 1 meter per second. At this point, the kinetic energy of the block is 1/2 joules. Now, because the kinetic energy equation has a factor of speed squared, we see something rather interesting. If we double the speed of the block to 2 meters per second, the kinetic energy increases by 2 squared times. It becomes 4 times larger. So changing the speed of an object has a big impact on its kinetic energy. But in this equation, there is another factor that contributes to the kinetic energy of our object, the object's mass. If we now think about a second block traveling at exactly the same speed as the first, but with half the mass, then this second block will have half the kinetic energy of the first block. Coincidentally, this is why a big truck or lorry traveling at the same speed as a small car is more dangerous. It has more mass and therefore more kinetic energy to transfer if it were to crash into something. Now, there are a couple of things to note here. Firstly, that v represents the speed of the object, which is a scalar quantity, and not its velocity, which is a vector. In other words, our block moving in this direction at 2 meters per second has the same kinetic energy as the same block moving in any other direction at 2 meters per second. What matters is the speed, not the direction. Secondly, there's this factor of 1/2. Why is it there? Why is the kinetic energy 1/2 mv squared rather than just mv squared or something? Luckily, we'll see one reason for the 1/2 being there in level 4 of this video. For now though, let's move on to the next level. Level 3. If you're familiar with the idea of reference frames, then this next thought might have occurred to you at some point during the first two levels. When we talk about kinetic energy, we always mention the speed of the object. But it's worth remembering that the speed is always measured relative to something. In other words, when we say an object is moving at 2 meters per second, what we usually mean is that it's moving 2 meters away from some point on the ground every second. In essence, the object is moving at 2 meters per second relative to the Earth. But let's imagine we're now on a different planet, let's say Mars, and we see the Earth moving this way. Let's ignore the rotation of the Earth just to keep things super simple. I know this is a bit strange, but run with me here. Let's also imagine that we somehow spot the object that we're considering on Earth, and it so happens to be moving at the same speed relative to Earth as the Earth seems to be moving relative to us, except the object is moving in the opposite direction to the Earth. So to us, from Mars, it looks like the object is not moving at all. So from Mars, we would say, well, the object has no kinetic energy at all because to us, it's not moving. Whereas our friends on Earth would say, what nonsense, of course the object is moving along the ground, so it has kinetic energy. Who is correct? The answer is that both perspectives are right. From our point of view, or our reference frame, the object has no kinetic energy. From the Earth's reference frame, the object does have a lot of kinetic energy. But how can this be possible? Well, it's important to note that the kinetic energy of an object does indeed depend on the object's mass and speed, as we've already discussed, but in reality, the value of any energy doesn't really matter. What really matters is how this energy changes. For example, increases in kinetic energy or changes to other forms of energy like gravitational potential energy. Level 4. Up until now, we've been dealing with nice, friendly Newtonian physics. This means we're assuming that Newton's laws of motion made up the correct description of the universe. But we can now switch to thinking about kinetic energy in the framework of special relativity. This is one of two theories of relativity developed by many important scientists, but most famously Albert Einstein. It assumes something is true about our universe that is not immediately obvious to us. Let's imagine we're watching a car driving past us, and the driver throws out a ball. What speed do we measure the ball to be moving at? Well, we would measure it as moving at the speed of the car plus the speed at which the driver threw the ball. But special relativity assumes that this isn't exactly how the world works. The velocity of the ball as seen from the ground is very slightly different to the sum of the velocities of the throw and of the car. This effect is the most important with light, where relativity says that everyone will measure light to be moving at the same speed. So if the car were to shine a flashlight out the front, we would not measure the light from it to be moving at the speed of light plus the speed of the car. We'd just measure it as moving at the speed of light. But so would the driver of the car. In order for this to be possible, different reference frames have to perceive space and time differently. This is a really strange idea if you've never seen it before, so I'll leave some stuff in the description below if you want to find out more. But as a result of these interesting assumptions about the universe, special relativity deals with kinetic energy in a slightly different way to Newtonian physics. You may be familiar with the equation E is equal to mc squared, which tells us that in relativity, the energy that any object has is equal to its mass multiplied by the square of the speed of light. But this expression is only part of the story. The equation E is equal to mc squared only applies to objects at rest in our reference frame. If the object is moving, then this is the full equation we need to use. P is the momentum of the object, which is related to its velocity, c is the speed of light, and m is its mass when it was at rest. For a quick exercise, see if you can prove how to get to E is equal to mc squared from this equation. But the reason this equation is brought up at all is because this expression can be used to work out the relativistic kinetic energy of an object. And we'll also see a link to the classical 1/2 mv² equation pretty shortly. The logic we'll use here is that in relativity, an object has some amount of energy even if it is at rest compared to us. Then when it's moving, it has this amount of energy. So the kinetic energy it has is simply the energy it has gained because it started moving. This gain in energy is equal to the energy while moving minus the energy while it was stationary. Now, when the object is moving fairly slowly, meaning much more slowly than the speed of light, we can use what is known as the binomial approximation just to make the maths a little bit less busy. Again, if you want to know more, then links in the description below. But when we expand out these brackets, we see that there are lots of terms that we haven't yet written. Infinitely many, in fact, that get smaller and smaller in size. Now this mc squared here cancels with this minus mc squared, and thus the biggest and most important term in the kinetic energy of our relativistic particle is this one. But if we were working in classical physics, we could rewrite the kinetic energy in terms of the particle's momentum rather than just in terms of its mass and velocity. And if we were to do that, we would get this expression, exactly the same. This is one way of understanding where the factor of 1/2 comes from. And we can see that the relativistic kinetic energy is an infinite set of terms that gets smaller and smaller, thus correcting to the actual energy by smaller and smaller amounts. And the classical kinetic energy is just the first, biggest term in the approximation. Level 5. At this point, it's time to take a breather. we've just seen a fairly intense treatment of kinetic energy. Things definitely get way more involved and complicated than this, but for level 5, I wanted to introduce a few ideas that aren't necessarily mathematically difficult, but maybe conceptually difficult. The first thing I wanted to mention in this level is that we've discussed a lot about what we've called kinetic energy so far. But in reality, we were only looking at one aspect of kinetic energy, linear kinetic energy. This is the energy an object has due to it moving in a straight line. However, if our object was to spin, or to rotate, or move along a curved path, then we need to consider what's known as its rotational kinetic energy. This rotational kinetic energy, of course, depends on the speed of the object's angular motion, or in other words, what angle it's covering per second. But the other quantity that the rotational kinetic energy depends on is not the mass of the object, but rather what's known as its moment of inertia. Just like how the mass of an object is a measure of how hard it is to move it along a straight line, the moment of inertia is a measure of how hard it is to make our object rotate or move in an angular manner. It does depend on the object's mass, but also depends on the shape of the object. So, rotational kinetic energy is worth checking out if you want to find out more, links in the description. I also want to quickly discuss how kinetic energy is dealt with in quantum mechanics. In the theory of quantum mechanics, an object's kinetic energy once again looks like this when written in terms of its momentum, but the tricky thing with quantum mechanics is that this hat above the P represents an operator. An operator is what we use to make a measurement on a system or an object that we're studying. In other words, our object does not necessarily have kinetic energy or momentum. Instead, we apply a momentum operator to our object. The difference between these two ideas is very subtle, but relativity and classical physics assume that our object just has this kinetic energy all the time, and we simply calculate it or measure it. Whereas quantum mechanics assumes that the system collapses into a state of having a particular momentum or kinetic energy when we make the measurement. At least, that's how the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics deals with it. I've discussed this strange idea in more detail in this video up here, so check it out if you haven't seen it already. And this brings us to the end of the 5 levels of kinetic energy. I hope you found some of it useful. If you have, please hit the thumbs up button and subscribe for more fun physics content. Hit that bell to be notified when I upload, and please check out my merch linked down below. It's a quantum dice design based on a famous quote from Albert Einstein. Finally, I'd like to say a big thanks to all my Giga patrons and to all of my other patrons over on my Patreon. This is also linked in the description if you'd like to support me on there. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you very soon.